Diabetes mellitus, also known as an increase in sugar levels, is one of the diseases of high importance and prevalence. Before describing the disease, let's discuss the anatomy and structures of the endocrine system, which are glands that secrete their hormones into the bloodstream. The endocrine system consists of many major glands, such as the hypothalamus, the pituitary, the pineal, adrenal, thyroid, thymus, testes and ovaries, and pancreas, which is of our main concern in diabetes mellitus. Normally, the pancreas, consisting of a head, body and tail, is made up of acini that has an exocrine function, which means that they secrete their hormones into ducts. Between these acini, there are millions of clusters called islets of Langerhans, or pancreatic islets. These islets are of four main types. 15% made up by alpha islets, important for the secretion of the hormone glucagon. 80% made up by beta cells are important for the secretion of insulin. 5% made up by delta cells, important for the secretion of somatostatin. And the remainder F cells that release pancreatic polypeptide. Normally, each hormone has a specific function. Once food containing carbohydrates is taken in, it will reach the stomach and intestines, in which it will be degraded to glucose, which is the major sugar in the body. Glucose is taken up by the intestines by active transport. This glucose will circulate in the blood before reaching the pancreas by splenic artery and pancreaticoduodenal artery. Glucose will reach the beta cells and bind to a specific cell receptor called GLUT2 receptor, or glucose transporter 2 receptor. This causes potassium channel inhibition, leading to depolarization that causes opening of calcium channels, secreting insulin. Now, insulin binds to its tyrosine kinase receptor in the liver, adipose tissue, and muscle. The main function of insulin is to decrease blood glucose levels in blood by the following mechanisms. It causes uptake of glucose by GLUT4 into cells to be used up as energy, meaning that it will be removed from the blood. It also promotes formation of glycogen, which is the main glucose store, and inhibits the process of glycogenolysis, which is the breakdown of glycogen into glucose molecules. It decreases the process of gluconeogenesis, which is the formation of glucose in the liver. All these mechanisms decrease the blood glucose levels. This is the anatomy and physiology of the pancreas. Now moving on to our main subject of this video, which is diabetes mellitus. Diabetes mellitus is not a single disease. Rather, it's a group of metabolic disorders that share the same feature of elevated blood glucose levels, also known as hyperglycemia. There are two main types, which are type 1 and type 2 diabetes. To start off, type 1 diabetes, which is less common. This type of hyperglycemia is due to absolute insulin deficiency, in which the beta cells lack release of insulin, so the patient will have zero insulin production. This loss of beta cell function is due to a chronic long-lasting immunity, in which the body attacks the beta cells. This autoimmunity occurs via the following mechanisms. First of all, CD4+, which are normal T cells found in the body, will cause beta cell damage by activating macrophages, which can cause tissue injury by engulfing the cells. In addition, CD8 positive cells, also normal T cells, will directly kill beta cells by secreting their weapons called cytokines like interleukin 1 and interferon gamma. Moreover, the body, there will be autoantibodies against insulin and glutamic acid. So type 1 diabetes is strongly associated with genetic predisposition, including class 2 MHC on chromosome 6, in addition to HLA-DR3 and HLA-DR4, which are markers your body uses to know what cells belong to it. Now, a patient with type 1 diabetes will develop hyperglycemia, because no more insulin means no more glucose in the blood will be dealt with. This patient will also present with ketoacidosis, which is a high level of ketone bodies in the blood, because normal fatty acids are converted to triacylglycerides. But in the case of insulin deficiency, these fatty acids will be converted to ketone in the liver and transported to the blood. Moving on to type 2 diabetes, which is more common, Genetically, type 2 diabetes is more associated than type 1, in which there's a concordance rate of 50 to 90% between identical twins and 20 to 40% between relatives. This type of diabetes starts off due to peripheral receptor resistance, so receptors will no longer react or bind to insulin. So the beta cells will increase production in order to compensate. In a chronic condition, once insulin is not producing an effect, the pancreas will stop synthesizing insulin because it cannot meet with the high demands required by the body. Therefore, it starts with insulin resistance in tissues and ends up with beta cell destruction. Now, most diabetic patients are obese with a high body mass index. What's the reason behind this phenomenon? To start off, obese patients have increased fatty acids in muscles and the liver and other tissues. It's believed that fatty acids can affect the insulin signaling proteins, resulting in no effect of insulin. Second of all, adipose tissue, which is the fat storage, contain hormones called adipocytokines, divided into adiponectin, leptin, and resistin. Now, adiponectin and leptin are good hormones, while resistin is a bad hormone that can cause insulin resistance. So in a case of type 2 diabetes, adiponectin and leptin will decrease while resistin will increase. Third of all, a family of proteins called sirtuins are believed to have a good effect on insulin secretion. However, this mechanism is not well understood. The loss of insulin secretion can be due to two pathways. The first one is qualitative beta cell dysfunction, which occurs due to the abnormal release of insulin in small amounts that are not enough to overcome the hyperglycemia. The second type is quantitative beta cell dysfunction, which is due to the beta cell mass decrease. Before discussing the complications of diabetes, let's explain why these complications occur. These complications are due to metabolic changes, mostly due to the elevated blood glucose in the blood. The first one is called non-enzymatic glycosylation, meaning that glucose will bind to free amino acids in the blood spontaneously. These will produce advanced glycosylation end products, or called AGEs. These are measured by the HbA1c test, which reflect blood glucose levels for the past 120 days. These AGEs forming on proteins like collagen cross links with polypeptides, trapping non-glycosylated proteins and enhance the deposition of cholesterol, hence accelerating atherosclerosis, which is a formation of plaque in the blood vessels that can lead to MI. Another metabolic reaction is that insulin activates a protein kinase C. Once it binds to its receptor, this protein kinase C will induce vascular endothelial growth factor, causing formation of new blood vessels. The last metabolic reaction is interfering with the polyol pathway. Some tissues that, like the lens, nerves, kidneys, and blood vessels do not require insulin for glucose transport. So an increase in glucose causes its efflux to these tissues, where glucose will be transformed to sorbitol and fructose, causing an influx of water that will lead to complications discussed later. Now, how do we diagnose a patient whether he is diabetic or not? In order to diagnose a patient as diabetic or not, we use a lancet device in which a drop of blood is taken from the patient, usually the index finger, and inserted on a disposable strip, and glucose levels are measured. Now, if random blood glucose level, which is measured at any time of the day, if the reading is more than 200 mg per deciliter, then the patient is diabetic. Fasting blood glucose level, which is measured after 8 hours of fasting with a reading of 126 mg per deciliter or higher, means that the patient is diabetic. Oral glucose tolerance test, in which a patient is given 75 grams of glucose with a reading of more than 200 mg per deciliter after 2 hours of taking the glucose, suggests that the patient is diabetic. Complications. Now, with any disease comes complications with signs and symptoms. The onset, which are early complications of diabetes, are polyuria, which is excessive peeing, polydipsia, which is excessive thirst, and polyphagia, which is excessive eating. As for long-standing diabetes, which is left untreated, many problems may take place. First of all, on the cardiovascular system, myocardial infarction can occur due to the accelerated rate of atherosclerosis. Second of all, on the kidneys, it can cause nephropathy, which is a renal disease requiring regular dialysis. On the eyes, it can cause visual impairment and sometimes total blindness, in addition to glaucoma and cataract formation due to the sorbitol and fructose. On the nervous system, it can cause neuropathy with the loss of feeling in extremities and loss of bladder control. It can also cause an increase in susceptibility to infections like gangrene or even infections in the bladder because glucose is a favorable environment to microorganisms. After discussing diabetes mellitus and its complications, how can we prevent it or treat it? As for the treatment, it differs between type 1 and type 2. Starting off with type 1, since there is absolute insulin deficiency, hence the treatment will be replacing the missing insulin. These are given as an insulin pen, syringe or pump, which senses the body glucose levels and accordingly pumps insulin at the needed time. These insulin shots are of four types, according to the onset of action. They are either rapid, regular, intermediate or long-acting. A patient with type 1 diabetes is given two shots of a mixture of 50-50 or 75-25, intermediate to regular. Two-thirds of this dose is given in the morning to prevent fasting hyperglycemia, and one-third is given in the evening to prevent nighttime hypoglycemia. They are given subcutaneous at a 45-degree angle in the buttock with the slowest absorption or in the abdomen with the fastest absorption, or it can also be given in the thighs or arms. As for a type 2 diabetic patient, there is insulin, however there is peripheral resistance, so we give agents that increase the secretion of insulin, furthermore to decrease the resistance, or we give agents that deal with glucose in the blood. First of all, biguanides, or known as metformin with the market name of glucophage. It increases the uptake of glucose in the blood, also decreases the uptake of glucose in the gastrointestinal tract, and decreases the process of making glucose, which is gluconeogenesis, in the liver. Metformin is known as an oral insulin sensitizer because it deals with the glucose in blood, so it does not cause hypoglycemia, which is severe drop in blood glucose below normal levels. Its off-label use is for weight loss. The second class of drugs, also known as sulfonylureas, known as glimepiride, glyburide, glipizide, sold under the trade name Amaryl. Their mechanism of action is oral insulin secretagogues, meaning they increase the secretion of insulin by blocking the potassium pump. Therefore, it will cause depolarization of the cell that increases the calcium influx, which in turn secretes more insulin. This can cause hypoglycemia and weight gain. Incretin mimetics is the third class of drugs. They are also known as exenatide. They increase the incretin effect, which is when taking glucose, the gastrointestinal system will stimulate the release of products called GLP-1 and GIP, which increase insulin. They are injectable and their off-label use is weight loss. The fourth class of drugs is DPP-4 antagonists, also known as sitagliptin. Normally, DPP-4 is an enzyme that breaks down the aforementioned GLP-1 and GIP. So this drug will stop the action of DPP-4, which will increase the amount of insulin. The fifth class of drugs is known as sodium glucose transporter 2 inhibitors, also known as dapagliflozin, that works on inhibiting GLUT2 transporters in the proximal tubule of the kidney, hence stopping the reabsorption of glucose and decreasing its amount in the blood. However, this type of drugs can cause infections. This is all you need to know about diabetes mellitus, its anatomy, physiology, its pathology, and the treatment of it. Thank you for watching.